5 seconds. Start. Sir, I rise to support the demands for grants of the Ministry of External Affairs and their report submitted to this House. As the Honorable Minister of State for External Affairs, Shri Natwar Singh said yesterday, the test of a national policy is that it has a national consensus behind it. Even when there was a change of government and a new government came into being after the Congress Party's defeat in 1997, the nation stuck to the same policy with regard to foreign affairs. When somebody pointed out to Shri Vajpayee, the then Minister for Foreign Affairs, that his role and his speeches as a Jan Sangh leader were contradictory to his role and his speeches as the Foreign Minister of India, he replied that he was concerned with the foreign policy of the government of India and not with the foreign policy of the Jan Sangh. So that shows that the foreign policy of India based on a national consensus had emerged as an important concept for the nation to follow and that it did not undergo any change even when the complexion of the government changed. India is one of the very few parliamentary democracies where there is a strong national consensus behind its foreign policy because it is based on sound principles of non-alignment, Panchsheel and similar other concepts which were outlined even before our independence. It is a tribute to the vision and genius of the leaders of our national struggle that the Asian Relations Conference was held before India attained independence, that India became a member of the United Nations. We are one of the founding fathers of that institution. During the year under review, a noticeable change has taken place and it is welcome change. The focus has changed to Asia. We have taken due note of the Asian dimension in the evolution of our foreign policy. Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi's stop over in Tokyo during his visit to Canada to participate in the Commonwealth Heads of the Governments Conference was the first sign of this, and the recent visit of the Prime Minister to Japan has strengthened the impression that we are not forgetting the Asian dimension in our foreign policy formulations. The commemorative Asian Foreign Relations Conference held last year and the talks between our government and the Foreign Minister of Japan were also significant developments in this connection. What I want to emphasize is that one of the historical distortions that came into our foreign policy in the initial stages was that we were being exposed to the Western influences for a pretty long time. We were more oriented towards the West, and as a result, the cultural linkages between the Asian countries, China, Japan, Indonesia, and Southeast Asia were not explored and exploited to the extent to which they should have been from the very beginning. So, even in the United Nations, Japanese is regarded as a hard language. But we should provide for and we should have some sort of scope for greater and more frequent cultural exchanges between Asian countries on the one hand and India on the other. At this moment, we are more oriented towards the West in our literature, in our culture. But basically, our roots are with countries in Asia, with Japan, with Sri Lanka, with China, with Indonesia. So, setting up of the departments for Japanese and Chinese studies in Delhi University was a step in the right direction. I would plead with the Minister of State for External Affairs that this movement is to bring Asia into focus in our universities, in our diplomatic relations, in our adventures, is given a greater push, and we are able to take into account the developments in Asia more vigorously and more seriously than has been the case hitherto. As regards China, I am of the opinion that the efforts of the government of India to normalize her relations should be hailed by that country, because we are bound by traditions of cultural affinity. And now the times are changing. China of today is not the same China which was prior to 1979, when USA also recognized China, though India was primarily responsible for pleading their case for admission to the UN. China is undergoing vast changes, and there are talks now of Sino-Soviet summit. Though there are some defects also, but this shows that the winds of change are blowing. China has also put three conditions for such a summit. One of the conditions is almost fulfilled, that is withdrawal of the Soviet troops from Afghanistan. The second was the reduction in the presence of Soviet armies on the border with China, and the third is the withdrawal of Vietnam forces from Kampuchea. In this connection, I would suggest to the Honorable Minister for External Affairs that the Indian initiative for solving the Kampuchean problem is also taken up with renewed vigor, because once this problem is sorted out, we will have lesser tension in Asia.